Welcome to the Midnight Matinee, where film taste goes to die.
I'm Mark.
And I'm Craig.
And I'm missing Oktoberfest for this.
On this episode of the Midnight Matinee, a review of Red, starring Bruce Willis. But as always, first up, some movie news.
Because we here at Midnight Matinee like routines.
Straight missionary sex here all the time.
The Hobbit has finally been greenlit for two films, which will start filming in February, and Peter Jackson will direct. But there is dispute on whether or not it's going to be filmed in New Zealand, because there's a lot of controversy with the labor unions, and there are talks that it might actually be filmed in Ireland.
Never saw a man as rich as that look so homeless.
Well, I'm pretty ecstatic about this news. I'm a pretty big Tolkien fan. I love Jackson's original treatment of the first three books. It's this whole thing with the labor unions is kind of unfortunate, but I think the vision of Tolkien is so expansive that so long as you have a lot of, you know, greenery and dense woods and anything like it, you could pretty much set it wherever you want. Although it would be a shame if the physical continuity of it had to suffer because they couldn't reuse the same locations. But all in all, I'm still happy it's actually finally getting made.
Green, for lack of a better word, is good.
Next up on movie news, director Paul Verhoeven of RoboCop fame will be directing a movie about a man who gets involved in a dangerous affair with a woman who turns out to be a ghost.
I'm really excited about this. I'm a big Verhoeven fan. This one sounds more in the vein of Basic Instinct than RoboCop, but that's okay with me. Basic Instinct was a great movie. And Verhoeven hasn't done anything since Black Book, which was a movie he made back home. So I'm excited that he's doing an American movie again, and I'm looking forward to see his own personal brand of blood and carnage on the big screen once more.
Well, I also like Paul Verhoeven very much. Despite all the bad mouthing about Starship Troopers, I think there was a certain quality of Paul Verhoeven to that movie. And I'm looking very forward to seeing another movie by him.
Talk about that. What about the bad mouthing in Hollow Man? I really liked Hollow Man. Nobody else did. And finally, Tom Hardy has officially been added to the cast of Nolan's third Batman film in what's supposed to be a lead role.
Well, it's not really a surprise that Nolan wanted to cast him. He was pretty great in Inception, so...
Mm-hmm.
And I would hope to think he'd be playing a villain.
I assume. I don't know what other lead role there would be now.
Yeah,
they got Commissioner Gordon and Alfred and all of them. All
right.
I did also personally love his interpretation of the character Eames in Inception. It was wonderfully flamboyant, fitting of any great Batman villain, of course. So I think Tom Hardy will be really good. And it is also... I mean... I don't really think there was too much doubt, but it is good to know that, you know, ink to paper, Christopher Nolan will be directing the third Batman.
And next up, DVD recommendations. Today, I'm going to recommend Firestarter, starring Drew Barrymore, David Keith, Martin Sheen, and George C. Scott, directed by Mark L. Lester. Firestarter is a book-to-screen adaptation of a Stephen King novel of the same name. Firestarter is about Charlie McGee, played by Drew Barrymore, and David Keith, who plays Andy McGee, her father. And they're evading capture from a secret organization known as The Shop. Andy McGee and his wife Vicky were experimented on by The Shop, given psychokinetic ability. The Shop soon discovers that they have a child who possesses a pyrokinetic ability and seek her for experimentation. Martin Sheen plays Captain Hollister, the leader of The Shop, and George C. Scott plays John Rainbird, a man that Sheen hires to capture Charlie McGee. I have to say this is one of the better Stephen King adaptations. It's a very intriguing story about a father and daughter. Yes, some of the dialogue is a bit wooden, but I have to say, more so than not, the performances and the dialogue were good. The action sequences were pretty awesome in scale, and because they were all done practically, made it look even more realistic. I really enjoyed Martin Sheen and George C. Scott, as Martin Sheen played the evil director of the shop and was perfect for this role. and George C. Scott playing the sadistic bastard who just wanted to kill Charlie McGee for his own personal gratification. I really enjoyed the father-daughter relationship between David Keith and Drew Barrymore. Drew Barrymore was one of the better child actors of the time, and David Keith was actually a very good actor, or as I like to call him, Patrick Swayze Light. And I won't reveal the ending, but let's just say, ends with a bang. Pun intended.
The movie I'd like to recommend is The Big Lebowski, directed by the Coen brothers, starring Jeff Bridges, John Goodman, Julianne Moore, and Steve Buscemi. The plot of The Big Lebowski revolves around Jeffrey the Dude Lebowski, a slacker and a pacifist with a strong penchant for white Russians, bowling, and smoking the occasional joint. The dude comes home one evening to find himself being accosted by two thugs demanding money from him. Bemused by this, the dude, of course, has no idea what they're talking about, and it's revealed that they've confused him for another richer man who actually goes by the same name. What follows this case of mistaken identity is a brilliant and wacky odyssey in which the dude, amid the occasional flying dream, must encounter all manner of seedy and oddball characters, including nihilists, known pornographers, a promiscuous trophy wife, a seemingly overachieving millionaire, and of course the dude's two best friends, Walter and Donnie, who are also members of his bowling team. The performances are wonderfully eccentric and stellar across the board, especially that of Jeff Bridges in the main role, who brings a certain human quality to an otherwise deadbeat character. You just can't help but feel bad for him, because of course, all the dude really wanted was his rug back. The Big Lebowski is a film that definitely has to be seen before it can even be remotely understood, and one that could have only possibly come from the minds of Joel and Ethan Coen. It's certainly atop the list of my personal favorite movies, and while it can be a polarizing, love-it-or-hate-it film, I think everybody should give The Big Lebowski at least one viewing, because if you do fall into the category of those who love it, you won't be able to help yourself from watching it over and over and over again.
I particularly didn't like The Big Lebowski. I thought it was kind of weird. And some of the funny parts that were supposed to be funny, I didn't find very funny. Yeah.
You also slept through half the movie, though.
My point is still valid.
You know who doesn't like The Big Lebowski?
Who?
Communists. You a communist?
Duh.
See? He's wrong and he has no taste. It's awesome. I'd like to deviate from the format this week and recommend a TV show instead. Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip was a short-lived show several years ago from Aaron Sorkin, who wrote The Social Network, which is currently in theaters, as well as The American President, Charlie Wilson's War, and A Few Good Men, and his, what many consider his magnum opus, The West Wing. In Studio 60, the producer of a Saturday Night Live-like sketch comedy show loses his job amidst a mid-air meltdown, and the new president of the studio, played by Amanda Peet, hires two former writers of the show to take his place, played by Matthew Perry and Bradley Whitford. The show, in addition to showing you the inner workings of a sketch comedy show, deals with issues like politics, religion, and any and all things in between. It's an extremely well-written show, as anything Aaron Sorkin does is, and it was very underappreciated and only got one season. Whereas the inferior but similarly themed 30 Rock is still going, well, maybe strong. And finally, a review of Red. Red is about a former CIA assassin, played by Bruce Willis, who finds himself targeted by his former employers and starts putting together his old team to try and figure out who's behind his own sanction.
Personally, I really enjoyed Red. I thought the ensemble cast was great, with brilliant performances all around. And I always enjoy movies that involve tough guy veterans always having to come back and be relevant again.
I also really enjoyed Red 2, and I really enjoyed John Malkovich being this really crazy, wild character. And I honestly have to say, he's probably so weird that the character he played in the movie was probably less weird than himself. And also, you might find this weird, but I still think Helen Mirren's a fox.
I appreciated the fact that the movie looked at retirement from all these different angles and used all the characters to do that. Bruce Willis sort of is living out the humdrum life of a man with no purpose anymore now that he lost his job. Morgan Freeman finds himself depressingly confined to a retirement home. John Malkovich is sort of the crazy old man who you could see watching the Weather Channel all day looking for weather patterns or spying on his neighbors or something like that. Gotta watch out for the satellites. Yeah. And Helen Mirren sort of tries to keep herself busy to in order to keep her sanity. And, like she says, takes the odd job here and there just to keep busy because she misses it.
Very matronly hobbies.
Yeah. And then she kills people sometimes, too.
Yeah. And Brian Cox plays the one of his...
the original Hannibal Lecter.
He plays this old friend of Bruce Willis's from the Russian side of things with the spies. And he's a really funny character. And
I had no idea he was actually in this movie. It was a surprise to me, and I'm glad that he showed up because he is... I do consider him one of my favorite character actors, and it's actually been a while since I've seen him in anything.
I was surprised to find out that Ernest Borgnine was still alive. Yeah. But it was great to see him again.
Well, a man well into his 90s and a legend in his own time.
You could see he wasn't all there.
Yeah,
he was just standing there. He's like, Bruce Willis, who's this guy? Where's Cary Grant?
It probably also should be mentioned that that Red is a comic book adaptation, although personally I didn't even know this, and going in fresh you wouldn't even necessarily consider it if you didn't see the
DC
the
label.
Yes, the DC Comics pre-credits bumper. And apparently it deviates from the source material, some say for the better. The story itself seems to function as something that we've seen in some capacity before, but it does work so well as we've all said because the ensemble is so great. Well, this just about does it for this episode of the Midnight Matinee. And as always, questions or comments down below.
And remember to email me at tmmatinee@gmail.com.
I would prefer if you didn't get in touch with me.
See you next time.